there is today in Germany a project which is called in German Gegen das Vergessen, translated as against forgetting, because the Germans are very concerned as well as we are, all should be, about forgetting, because we have been told over and over again, if we forget the past, we're condemned to repeat it. And this is what I'm trying to do, to inform all of you, as much and as many people as I can, because there's not going to be that many more years that I'll be able to do this, to make sure that you do not forget. Because if we forget, we're condemned to repeat it. Don't forget that. I'd like to go back to 1933, because we always are told the Holocaust started in 1939, ended in 45. Wrong. The Holocaust started actually with the beginning of the Third Reich in 1933, when immediately steps were taken to curtail, to limit the survival of Jews. First of all, it was the university professors that were dismissed, the school teachers that were dismissed, the banks that were Aryanized, so to speak, taken over for no money at all by Jewish banks were taken over by non-Jews. The limitations, for instance, doctors could not treat any but Jewish patients. The perimeter of Jewish survival got narrower and narrower over the years until it ended into the chimneys of Auschwitz-Birkenau. I myself came into what was become known as the Holocaust Kingdom. Excuse me a minute. I've got to know what time I have. As the Holocaust Kingdom in 1942. We had left Austria when Hitler marched into Austria to the enthusiastic acclaim of the Austrians, in spite of the fact that in 1945 they claimed themselves as the first victim of Hitler. In 1938 they threw flowers in front of his army and greeted him like a conquering hero. And in 1938, the Austrians displayed the charming, gemütlich Viennese, displayed an antisemitism that a Nazi officer who had marched in with the army said, we have been in Germany since 1938, we have been on ruling in Germany since 1938, and I've never seen such viciousness in antisemitism as is displayed in Austria. And due to that fact, Austrian Jews very quickly tried to leave as quickly as they could. We left in May of 1938, left behind a five-room apartment with clothes in the closet, the refrigerator full of food, the glass, the china, everything that we owed was in that apartment, and we knew that the next day some high-ranking SS man or army officer would march in there, take it over without a by your leave. The one thing that very few people realize is that the Third Reich was one of the biggest robbery campaigns the world had ever seen. They did not only rob the Jews, they robbed occupied countries too. As you might, some of you might have seen the in the newspapers in the last several years, the Swiss accounts of Jewish money that was deposited there and not returned to any survivor. The American government, the French government, everybody held some of the German gold that they deposited for future references. So everything was robbed. My parents and I, unfortunately, instead of going west, went east, went to Prague, because we had a branch of our business in Prague. I suppose I'll never know to the end of my life what prompted that decision, whether it was purely a business decision, but we went to Prague. And there was a joke in our family where Ernst Eckstein is my father, goes, Hitler goes. The joke unfortunately came true again in 1939. Hitler marched into Prague, into the Czech area. The Bohemia and Moravia were occupied by the German army. The Slovaks immediately declared their allegiance to Hitler, so they became an independent country. And we were, my father said, this can't last, we've got to get out of here. So he made some arrangements to go across the border into Poland and out of Poland to the west. Unfortunately, at that time he had to make the arrangements with some illegal border guards because the Poles already refused to give visas, entry visas into their country to anybody with a Jewish name. That sort of is the same thing as the Swiss forced the German, asked the German government to put a J into Jewish passports so Jews could not try to get into Switzerland to escape from Germany because they would turn them back at the border. Anyhow, my father had to make some arrangements with some illegal border guards. He made the arrangements, and when the time came to cross, which my mother said, well, you go ahead and the child and I will stay behind until we know that you're safe, which was totally illogical because if he would have been caught, he would have been killed and we would have been put in prison. But anyhow, he left on the 31st of August, 1939. If you remember your history lesson, World War II broke out on September 1st, 1939. My father managed to get out of Poland with practically the last plane, and my mother and I sat in the trap, literally in the trap. There was no way out. The Germans, between 1939 and 1942, left sort of the Prague, the occupied area in Bohemia and Moravia, left them sort of alone because they were very busy, exterminating the Polish Jews, and they exterminated them with fire and sword, if any of you were interested enough to look into the history, literally with fire and sword by the thousands, because Poland had the largest amount of Jewish population in Europe. And then when they finished with that, in the meantime, the military had occupied France and Belgium and Holland and Denmark. And so they figured, well, by now they had taken care of all the Jews, most of all the Jews in Poland, and it was some of them in a ghetto. It was time to fulfill the Führer's promise to eliminate all the Jews in Europe from the Western countries. And so they started transports out of Germany, out of France, and out of Austria. And in Prague, there was a head of the Jewish community who had enough access to information that he found out that those transports all went into Poland, into a place called Litzmannstadt, which was a relatively small city. They crammed thousands of Jews in there into a ghettoized area. Filth, hunger, deprivation, terrible, terrible conditions. And when Mr. Edelstein, the gentleman from Prague, found that out, he was desperately trying to find a way to save the Jewish population in the Bohemia and Moravia from that kind of deportation. So he had a brilliant idea. He was suggesting to the head of the security, Mr. Heydrich, Mr. Himmler, and also Hitler indirectly, to establish a ghetto in the middle of the Bohemian and Moravian area, let the Jewish people work for the German war effort, and thereby save them from the deportation. And he submitted that to the security, head of the security, Mr. Heydrich. And Mr. Heydrich thought it was a wonderful idea. Of course we're gonna do that. What he didn't tell Mr. Edelstein that the trio, Hitler, Himmler, and Heydrich, had already discussed the possibility of establishing a small ghetto in the most western occupied country, which was from the Eastern Bloc, the Bohemia and Moravia, and to sort of use that place as a transit station for the transports from the western occupied countries, and at the same time establish a sort of ghetto that could be shown to the free world as, look how marvelous we treat the Jews. They have their own autonomous government there. They have their own autonomous departments of education and health, etc. And of course, what they tried to tell the world was that in a town that normally, a garrison town with about 7 barracks, large barracks, and about 30 or 40 civilian houses out of the early 19th century, that in that small town of about 35,000 people, all the Jews of Europe were living marvelously. What they didn't tell, of course, the rest of the world was the transport that they brought in from the countries of the West were sort of selected as they came in. The word selection sounds like a very harmless word. You select a new car, you select the place to go on vacation. During the Holocaust for Jews, the word of selection meant one thing, live or die. I didn't realize that in Theresienstadt, actually the transport that came in were selected. My mother and I were informed that we were sent on a transport from Prague to Theresienstadt, the small town in the middle of Slovakia, it was the Czech area. And when we arrived there, we were all housed in a large area in one of the big barracks, sitting on the ground on straw, and some administrators from Theresienstadt, Jewish administrators, came in and they had the list of the people, of the entire transport, and they would say, well, you are a doctor, you and your family can stay here because we need doctors badly, and you must be an engineer according to the list here. So we need you here, you stay here with your family, and you are a relative of one of our administrators, so you stay here with your family, and the rest go east. And east meant 5 extermination camps: Sobibor, Bielsetz, Chełmno, Majdanek, and Treblinka. Camps that were nothing but a fake railroad station and 3 or 4 barracks in the back, where the transports, when they arrived, were sorted out only by if you're a goldsmith, if you're a silversmith, if you're a cobbler, if you're a tailor, people that were needed to dispose of the property of the victims, and the rest went directly into the gas, they were barracks, actually well-insulated barracks, and in the beginning they used carbon monoxide. Later on, they used Cyclone B, which was cyanide, and the corpses were then thrown into ditches behind the barracks and burned. When my mother and I arrived in Theresienstadt, there was some personal matter that I don't like to go into. I explained it in my book, but I don't like in general to go into it. We were selected to stay. But my mother had a friend with her, and he was not a relative of the family. And this friend of mine, who was part of the administration, who had taken my mother and I out to stay, said, well, he cannot stay with you because he's not a relative. And my mother said, well, if he can't stay, we all go. And this was the first time I was a very obedient child. And by that time, I was about 18 almost. And that was the first time in my life that I said no to my mother. I said, I'm not going. I'm staying here. If you want to go, you go. My mother was sort of taken aback, but that was my decision. And she went east. And when I took my children to Auschwitz the first time in 1993, I found out that she had gone to Sobibor, one of the 5 extermination camps. It probably was easier for her because even if she would have survived and been selected into Auschwitz-Birkenau, she would have gone through the horrors of the new arrival commandos and then went into the gas. It would have been much worse this way. At least I hope she didn't know what was waiting for her when they just took her into the barracks, supposedly to take a shower. I was in Theresienstadt until January 1943. By that time, Theresienstadt was getting rather crowded, and even the Nazis felt that there was a little too many people there. And besides that, they couldn't stop the deporting Jews. So now they had gone to the point of taking Jewish people that were left over in the occupied countries. that were protected by either a non-Jewish relative or by the sometimes the Nazi government, sometimes they were working in the leftover Jewish community offices. Anyway, these people were going to be deported into Theresienstadt. But somehow or other, by that time, I don't think the war was going as well as the Germans had hoped. And so while they were deporting these people, they told them, we are putting you into a resort camp for the rest of the war. Bring your best clothing, bring some valuables so you can buy yourself things, and we'll have a room. You can maybe reserve yourself a room with a view to the mountains. Well, if you deport people like that, you can't very well put them into freight cars. So these people were brought in old, old-fashioned passenger cars, third class, wooden benches. But you could sit down, and there were toilets at each end of these cars, each of these railroad cars. They were not very clean. But anyway, we had the luck that I was designated to go on transport, and we knew the word Auschwitz. Nobody knew what was waiting there, but we only knew the word Auschwitz and that nobody had ever come back. So I was designated to go on transport in January 28th, 1943. And it was my very great luck, mine and my transport, very great luck, that at that time one of the passenger trains had arrived at the railroad station. And of course the Germans, with their typical efficiency, would not get a second freight car train on the rails when they had a passenger train standing there. So we went east in the passenger trains, which was of course very fortunate, because the railroad cars, usually the freight cars, they were supposed to be, but actually horse trailers with I think 80 horses or 100 people was what is usually written on those cars, and usually they would stuff about 100 or 150 people in one of those freight cars, lock them up with two or three buckets in the middle, and there were tiny little slits of windows on top of each car. And invariably when any of these freight cars were opened upon arrival, there would be two or three corpses in those cars. We, as I said, were lucky that at least we were in this old-fashioned car, but at least we could sit down. And we could see approximately the directions we were going, so we knew Auschwitz obviously was northeast from Prague. Yeah, I think that was about the direction. When we arrived, the first thing that you noticed when they opened the doors and threw everybody out, the first thing that you noticed was an incredible smell. I can't even call it smell, it was a stink. It was a stink of, you couldn't define it. It was sweetish, it was nauseating, and the only thing you could bring it in contact with was in front of the direction where the train had come in. There was a large chimney, the flames shooting out of that chimney and black smoke curling ahead of it. And how could you define what the smell was? Because who in the 20th century had ever smelled probably 500 to 1,000 people under that chimney burning? We were told, women on one side and men on the other side, line up in rows of five. Strangely enough, I cannot remember whether men lined up, because I have a block about that somehow. We lined up to the left of the train, and to the left of us, between us and the fences that were on both sides of those ramps, and they were lit up periodically with lamps and with large Klieg lights, I guess they were. We didn't know, but that was the electrified fence. And between the fence and us stood a field gray ambulance, very normal looking, with a big red cross on it. So of course, what does a Red Cross designate? What does a Red Cross mean, represent? Help, international goodwill. Oh yeah, this ambulance with its big Red Cross on the hood and the Red Cross on the door was nothing else but a sham. It brought the boxes of Cyclone B gas to the crematoria in the direction of the chimney and brought the empty cans back. In front of that ambulance stood about two or three, depending on how big the transport was, trucks with tarps over them. And we stood in line in five rows of five. Two SS men walked out from a gate in that electrified fence, and the fence had opened up and they came out. One very well dressed with the medical insignia on his collar, the other one less well dressed and less well uniform. And they would look down the line and they would say, now you walk and you go by truck and you go by truck and you walk and you go by truck. And pretty soon a pattern evolved out of that. Anybody under 14 or looking weak or small enough to be under 14, and any woman, oh, about 38 or 40 or looking healthy, unhealthy or too heavy or whatever, or so over that age, went on the truck. And of course, every woman was a child. And what I tell you now, of course, I did not experience, because otherwise I wouldn't be here. But having been in Birkenau for over 2 years, I knew all the processes that were going on. The people that were put on the truck, of course, with the guard, just the women. Strangely enough, they always gassed the women first. Nobody has ever been able to find a trace of why that was done. But they were put on the truck, and they would ask the guard, now where's our fathers and our brothers, and where are our mothers going? And then they said, oh, don't worry about it. You get together with your family pretty soon again. You're going to take a nice shower, and you're going to feel so much better. And when they arrived in front of a brick building, which seemed to be below that chimney, the brick building, according to a Nazi doctor by the name of Dr. Wirth, had also been constructed to be non-threatening, to look like a peasant house. And said two windows on the side, a brick building, flowers in the front yard in summer, white picket fence. The only thing different was that you had to step a few steps down into the building. The entrance was sort of below the ground. The only reason for that was that they needed to have the roofs, the pitched roofs, low enough so where people could reach them and throw, and there were vents in the roof that could be open, and the Cyclone B would be thrown into the gas chamber from the top. Anyway, these women would, when they were led into this building, there was a dressing room. It looked like a swimming pool dressing room, about maybe half the size of this or a third the size of this, with the whitewashed, with slogans on the wall, one louse your death, etc. And there would be hooks along the wall, and the numbers under the hooks, and benches underneath. And the guards, because at that time there were only the guards with the prisoners, the guards would tell them, now get undressed, and remember the number you hang your clothes on, and if you have a child with you, be sure that the child is next to you, and be sure you tie your shoelaces together. They wanted the shoelaces together, so the people that, the prisoners that would work on the disposal of the property would find pairs together instead of having to try to pair them up. And sometimes they would give these women a piece of soap. And not until the doors clanged shut behind them when they were sort of led into what seemed like a very primitive shower room, blackened concrete walls, the pipes on the ceiling, the shower heads against the pipes, and not until the doors clanged shut and no water came out of the pipes and the shower heads did they know that something terrible happened. The fortunate thing is that the process went fast enough. And an SS man that I happened to have worked for a while for, by the name of Perry Broad, who sang like a canary after the war, has a very pure report of what happened in the gas chamber. With a hammer and a tong, they opened a harmless-looking boxes with the inscription, Cyclone, Vermin, Warning, Poisonous. These boxes were filled with little blue pellets that was cyanide gas, and when they opened the vents and poured the pellets in, they had to close the vents very quickly because the gas was that poisonous that the moment that it hit the air, people the assessment who threw that in would faint because it was that poisonous. They would throw this in, and please, after about 2 or 3 minutes, if there was not too many people in the gas chamber and enough gas, it didn't take much longer than 2 or 3 minutes that the commander, by the name of Grabner, SS man Grabner, would pull out his watch and he would look at it and he says, well, another 2 minutes and we can open. Because the screams had stopped down to a low moaning. And it finally, and when the moaning stopped, they would open the doors. And the bodies were just like, in almost like a pyramid, climbed to each other, trying, I guess, grasping for the air that might have been available. And the bodies were stiffened because the gas stiffened their bodies immediately. Assessman Perry Broad was asked how many people could be into one of the crematoria in one activity. And he said in crematorium 2 and 3, the main crematorium in the main concentration camp of Auschwitz, and I have a map here to show you where the camps were. In the main concentration camp, the gas chamber was not used because it was purely a concentration camp. In the extermination camp, crematoriums 2 and 3 could take 3,000 to 4,000 bodies in one action. Crematoria 4 and 5, only 2,000 at a time. There were gassings every day, and sometimes during the Hungarian transports in 1944, 3 and 4 a day. If you figure from September 1942, until November 1944, even if you just figure one transport a day, the figures that are given for the murders that happened in Birkenau are true, are horrendous. All you have to do is do the math. Those of us who were left standing, so to speak, at the ramp, were brought into the camp and underwent what was known as a processing in. And the processing in was part of a calculated decision made in January 1944 in Berlin, Wannsee, with a group under the chair of Security Chief Heydrich, with Adolf Eichmann keeping the record keeping. And there were 14 high-ranking SS men of all professions. I mean, lawyers, medical men, artists, journalists, anything that had anything to do with the Holocaust, the highest ranking. And among these 14 high-ranking people, 11 held doctorates, either medical doctorates or doctors of philosophy. Highly educated people, but without one sense of humanity. And among the calculations in this finalizing the final solution, so to speak, they also decided on how to treat incoming prisoners so they could be reduced physically and mentally as fast as possible. And the following was done according to the record. With all prisoners, and I can of course only speak for the women, but the same thing happened to the men. We were brought into the so-called sauna. It was a sauna, but it was never used as a sauna. We were brought into the sauna. You were told to undress, totally undress. You were shaven from top to bottom. You went under a two-minute ice-cold shower, don't forget, January 31st, 1943. Then you went into a large room in which was different tables were set up. On the first table, you were given the so-called underwear, which was a wooden feeling material, blue and white striped, boxer shorts with a string in them, and a shift. Then you were given at the next table the uniforms of dead Russian prisoners, because that is not too well known, that the Russian prisoners of war, officers or enlisted men, were sent directly from the battlefield to the extermination camp because the entire Slavic population was going to be the next to be exterminated after the Jews were exterminated. So all Russian prisoners were in the extermination camps, and the uniforms of these prisoners with the bullet holes in them, with the blood spots on them, were given to the new arrivals. They were long pants and a jacket with a little collar on it, long sleeves. The only thing that was visible of you were your hands and your face. The next table, you were given shoes if you were lucky. If you were unlucky, you were given wooden clogs. And I mean unlucky, you quasi signed your death certificate, because wooden clogs are the temple that the prisoners had, the new arrival prisoners had to move in the camp. A wooden clog without any socks, and we didn't have any socks, would rub your toes at your heels, would rub them raw. You have a wound within days, and there was absolutely no hygienic preparation for Jews, which meant there wasn't a band-aid, there wasn't a disinfectant, there was no running water anywhere. Within days, the wound was infected. Within a week, you had gangrene, you had blood poisoning, and you were ready for the gas. That eliminated some, very quickly decimated the new arrivals. After that, I was lucky enough to get a pair of, I think they were high tops if I remember correctly, but at least they were shoes. The next table was a table where they tattooed, where I got my tattoo, number 34042. And Birkenau and Auschwitz all tattooed. Other concentration camps did not tattoo. They only gave numbers on the clothing, but they didn't tattoo. But Birkenau and Auschwitz tattooed. But only Jewish prisoners that came with the transport were designated to go into the gas. And to make sure that they know the difference between a Jewish woman and a non-Jewish woman, because Jewish men were easily identified. All they had to do was have them drop trousers, and because Jewish men were circumcised. But how do you know a Jewish woman if you have a bit blue eyes, brown eyes, whatever, no hair? So you got to, and since only Jewish women from transports that came in with transports could be sent into the gas arbitrarily, they had to make sure that they designated Jewish women that came with the transport, and that is why I have under my number a little triangle. Without that triangle, if I wouldn't have that triangle, I could have been just any arbitrary prisoner and couldn't be sent to the gas. The strange thing was that if a Jewish prisoner had come into the camp with a Gestapo file, whether they had been caught in a raid or had been caught by black marketing or whatever. But if he had a Gestapo file, he could not be gassed. Only the so-called protective custody prisoners could be gassed immediately. Protective custody prisoners make the Jewish prisoners that were transported, rounded up and transported. And that for this reason, which I think is a very ironic name, I called my book Protective Custody Prisoners 34042. After we were given the number and a kerchief which had to be bound just a certain way, we got what I call the absolute bottom of dehumanization. A bowl about that big, about that deep, with sort of rust-colored enameled, which was our only utensil. We had no knife, no fork, no cup, no saucer, no handkerchief, no towel, nothing that made us human. You had a bowl to eat out of, to drink out of, to eliminate into. That was it. You were at the level of an animal. And you had to decide as soon as you got into the so-called block. They had the Jewish prisoners in these stone blocks. The stone blocks were about the height of chicken coops. I would say I could reach the guttering standing up straight. And there was two rows of bunks about the size, no, not quite as big as this table, and maybe a little deeper for about, originally those were the blocks that had been built for the Russian prisoners, but they had, the Russian prisoners in the meantime had kept being exterminated. And they used the stone blocks for the Jewish deportation, for the Jewish extermination prisoners. And these bunks, like I said, were about not quite as big, and sometimes they would, in the new arrival blocks, they would hold five or six prisoners, trying to sit on there, trying to sleep on there. Sleeping, of course, spoon by spoon, one turned around, everybody had turned around. And if you woke up in the morning and the person next to you had died in the meantime, you took what you could from her. Maybe she had a handkerchief, or maybe she had an extra loaf of, found an extra ration of bread, or maybe she had organized a knife or a spoon, something that maybe she had been longer than you. Anyway, you took whatever she couldn't use anymore, which could use help, you help, what could help you. Because you had to make up your mind very quickly, did you want to live or did you want to die? Dying was absolutely no art. It was the quickest thing you could do. You could. There was one block, block number 27, which was the so-called one Jewish hospital block. Of course, there was an entire hospital section in the Aryan side, on the other side of the camp, which were the Aryan blocks, which were fairly high, they were actually horse stables. They were prefab horse stable, high. And among those horse stables, there was about five or six that were the so-called hospital section with a lab and an operating room and everything up to date. On the Jewish side, there was one block 27. In the block 27, if you signed yourself in that block 27, the Nazi doctor would go through there two, three times a day. And in the bunk, you would be in a bunk, and if he saw you in the bunk and you looked like ready for the gas, he'd write your number out. The so-called block leader, Dr. Rose, the French Jewish doctor, she would then have to collect these people that had the numbers, take them to the gas, and that was that. Dying was no great art, but surviving, you had to learn. And we got our first lesson of survival when we came into the block. But out of my transport of about 500 women and children, 62 got a number and got into the camp. We 62 came into this block, block 3 in the so-called A camp. And when we got in, the block workers were mostly Slovakian Jewish girls who had come in 1942 and had, of course, those who survived had gotten all the jobs when Birkenau, when the extermination camp was opened. And these girls would tell us, and since we could communicate with them, because Slovak and Czech is very similar, so we could talk to them. Language in camp was a matter of survival. That's what I always told my students when I taught at UNCC and I prof languages. Language could mean death or survival if you understood at least one of the languages that were the main language of the camp, either German or Slovak or Polish. So we could, with Slovaks, they could understand us, and they told us, now go up there on the top bunk. And we said, we're tired, why would you have to climb up the top bunk? There was no ladder to climb up there, you had to manipulate yourself over the bottom bunk into the top bunk. And they said, listen to us and take the top bunk if you possibly can. And we found out very truly, very quickly, how right she was. Because if you had to go out at night, go to the bathroom with that too, there were three blocks that were the new arrival blocks, block 1, 2, and 3. Block 1 was right behind the fence, block 2 and block 3, and block 3 faced the camp street. Behind block 1, to the right of block 1, was the latrine. You were not allowed to use the latrine, of course, at night. And at night, there were two or three buckets that were in front of the door of the block with a night guard, one of the block workers as a night guard, and she had a big stout stick. And when you came out and you wanted to use a bucket, and the buckets were full, and if she didn't feel like, she was the one that, of course, had to carry them, empty them into the latrine to carry them back there. And if they were rather full and she didn't feel like emptying them, you got one about your up on your hind end, and she would say, get lost. And what do you do then? You use your bowl. And what do you do when your bowl is full? Well, the bunks were set into, the beams of the bunks were set into little wooden stone walls, and then the boards were laid over those beams. And between the stone wall and the boards, there was a little slit, and that's where you poured your bowl down and who got it? The ones underneath. That was your first lesson. Your second lesson was the next morning when they brought in these large kettles of hot stuff. They called it sometimes coffee, sometimes tea, but it was hot. And they said, drink as much as you can because any faucet you find in the camp is poison to start with and is full of bacteria, typhus bacteria. So try to drink as much as you can of this hot water or hot whatever it is. And then wash your hands and face, or wipe them at least as much as you can, because we had no handkerchief or nothing to wipe with, so you had to do it by hand. Because if you have smeared hands or smeared face, that's a good reason to take you into the gas, because there's a selection every morning, and if you have a smeared hand or face, that means that you have no self-esteem, you have no self-respect, you can't keep yourself clean, you're ready for the gas. Lesson number two. And after that, there would be the roll call. You would stand in roll call for about sometimes 2-3 hours at a time, because why the numbers had to do tally, I could never figure out. I mean, they wanted us to die by the numbers, but there always would be somebody would fall dead in the roll call, or somebody was hiding inside the block. The roll call could last 2 or 3 hours. And by the time you then were ready, then the so-called capos came in to select for their commanders. The capos that came in were German criminal women who were in charge of organizing the camp. And they had to organize the commanders to work on the outside commanders. The outside commanders were the commanders that would drain ditches, would drain swamps, would root out trees, would build railroads, would build roads. Everything was a pick or a shovel and nothing else, and 8-7 hours a day. And I always call these the death commandos, because if you did not manage to get out of these outside commandos, you were doomed. Anyway, that we learned pretty quick. Then after they had selected their commandos, you would be marching out with the strains of this wonderful orchestra, women's Jewish women's orchestra, would be marching out to the gate. And on the side again stood the doctor and the other SS men, and they would make the selection again. And this time they wouldn't say you walk or you go by truck, because we all walked, but they would look down these road of five. And if you have a smeared face, or if you had scabies in your face, or if you were so skinny that you looked like a death head, or if you were had your kerchief maybe not tied under the chin because that was the last strength you had. It's all really reasons to pull you out and stand you on the side. The rest marched out, and these people would be sent to Block 25. Block 25 was the death block where they collected the people to go to the gas every night. And at night when the commandos came back, another selection, another group sent to Block 25, and then when the curfew was whistled, and in summer would be about 8:30, and winter about 7:30 or 6:30, I don't know, I don't quite remember. Anyway, when curfew was whistled, the trucks would drive up to the Block 25 and take the daily harvest to the crematorium. And these women didn't go quiet, they screamed and they prayed and they hollered and they even sang, just to defy showing that they knew where they were going, and they were not afraid. They were not going to give them the satisfaction to see them beg for anything. Because we knew from the very first day on what Birkenau was. The genus Auschwitz is extermination camp, but the actual name of the place was 5 kilometers north of Auschwitz, was called Birkenau. And when we arrived, and you would ask what's happening of the people that did not come into the camp, and the workers in the camp would say, do you see that chimney smoking there? That's where your family just went up to the heaven. So, you know, it's nothing you could do, that was it. But you had to find out real quick that the one way of survival was to get an inside job. Because if you stayed on this outside commando, where you never got a change of clothes, where you never had a means of bathing, where you never had a means of keeping yourself clean, or never had a means of making any contact to get any more food, because starvation was the first weapon they had against you. So you had to find a way to get out inside the camp, even if it meant cleaning the latrines or cleaning the camp street, whatever, just to get out of this daily selection and get out of those blocks. My main point was that you had to find someone to whom you could contact on the inside. I don't know whether it was just the tacit agreement in the women's camp or whether it was in the men's camp too, but in the women's camp you had to find somebody who knew of you, who knew a relative of you or something that you could get in touch with, who might provide you a job. Because if a woman from the outside commando contacted somebody who worked on the inside, it was the obligation of the inside worker to try to get a job for the outside worker. I was extremely lucky in that direction, because when in block three that I was in, existing, I can call it living, but existing, the block leader, the block eldest, was a Slovakian by the name of Ilka Grün. And Ilka spoke very little German, but no French at all. And there were French and German Jewish women in the block, and so I helped her with sort of interpreting when she needed it. And one day when I came when she asked me into her little block room, because ever so often she'd ask me that, rewarding me with a cup of coffee or a cigarette. And one day when she invited me in there, there was a runner from the administrative office. The runners from the administrative office were quasi the telephone of Birkenau, because there was no telephone in Birkenau. And these girls would run and carry messages and orders and whatever to the block elders. And this girl was one of the runners when she was visiting with Ilka, because all the Slovaks, of course, knew each other. And so we started talking. She introduced me and we started talking. And it turned out that she and I had a friend in common in Prague, a journalist by the name of Jimmy. And that, of course, was immediately the reason for her to get me out of the outside commando. 2 days later, I was in the administrative office after having been bathed and freshly shaven and freshly deloused and gotten the clothing, the striped clothing and an apron and a kerchief and even different shoes and socks. I remember I had socks. And I was set behind a large book, the so-called big book, which was the first record keeping that was given when you came into the camp. In this big box book, there would be your name, your number, your name, your age, and your profession. And from this book, all the other records were kept in the work department and in the hospital department. They all were cataloged according to this book. And you would sit in front of this book and write in the names and numbers, etc., of new arrivals. And I am famous for having a lousy handwriting. And at that time, it already was rather bad. And the administrator the Jewish administrator, she was the highest Jewish position in the camp, and a woman by the name of Katya Zinger. And Katya was very, how shall I say, persnickety about how her big book was kept, and it should be just perfect writing and perfect neat writing, and my handwriting just didn't suit her. And so she kicked me out, but another tacit agreement in the women's camp was that even when you were kicked out of an inside job, you couldn't be sent outside to the outside commando. You could be demoted, you could be promoted maybe to a higher position, and strangely enough, she sort of, I would say, promoted me into the construction department. And in that construction department, I typed specifications for camps from the Polish border to practically past the Ural Mountains for construction of camps for every nation, for every occupied nation of Europe that the Germans were planning to conquer, because they were planning to, how should I say, to fill Europe with nothing but pure Aryan German. And the only people that were not going to be interned or decimated or sterilized were the Scandinavian countries and the British, because they were probably Aryan enough. because the thousand-year Reich had far-reaching plans. Fortunately, they did not come to fruition. After I worked in the construction department, I was transferred to the so-called Canada Commando. The Canada Commando was probably the elite commando of the camp, because in that commando, since the existing of Birkenau, all the clothing of the transports, people that went in the gas and people that were put into the camp, all their clothing, all their property, was collected by the Canada Commando and was sorted out neatly by items, men's clothing, women's dresses, women's suits, men's suits, fur coats, men's winter coats, women's winter coats, baby clothing, children's clothing, boys' clothing, girls' clothing. Everything had its own barracks in that large camp, in the so-called Canada camp, and was sorted neatly in stacks. And whenever a train arrived, it brought in people to send to the gas. After the train was cleaned out, we loaded those trains to the roof with clothing into Germany, because by that time, of course, Germany didn't have much manufacturing, textile manufacturing, and Germany was provided with the clothing of dead Jews since 1942, practically. I find this rather ironic. And so due to the fact that there too there had been a silent agreement between the heads of that commando, the SS heads of the commando, and the prisoners, the SS was forbidden to take one button out of that commando. And so, but after all, they had their families and they needed clothing. And so even though the prisoners could have denounced any assessment or took anything, we said nothing. We let them drag out entire suitcases full of stuff. And in return, the SS would hand over to the prisoners, to the entire commando, every bit of food that was brought in by transport, because this transport, of course, had been told, you were going to go to a work camp. You have never told the truth, of course. You're going to a work camp. You're going to be there for the duration of the war. But for the first few days, how about bringing some of your own food, which might last you until you get yourself settled down in the working camp? And all people brought any durable food that they could think of, they would bring with them, whether it was salami, whether it was condensed milk, whatever they could. And all that came in with every transport was all given to the Canada Commando and was evenly divided between the 500 people, about 300 men and 200 women, and was evenly divided. And therefore, the Canada Commando, of course, were the only one that had halfway normal food. So we were, and they didn't cut our hair anymore, so we had our own hair and we had halfway normal food. That's what made us the elite commando. But what happened now, and when I never leave out when I mention that, one of the most important things to point out to you, that not everything in the Holocaust was either black or white. Not all Nazis were totally bad, not all Jews were totally good. And I have to hand over to you one incident that I think I want you to remember, because one man, and I don't know, and one SS man, and I don't know what he did before he was in the Canada Commando, before he was the head of the Canada Commando, I don't know whether he killed or shot or murdered anybody, but in Birkenau, Werner Hahn, the SS man who was in charge of the commando, on January the 17th, the night of January 17th to 18th, came into all the barracks of the men and the women and said, people, go into all the barracks, pick yourself out the warmest clothing you can find, the best shoes, get some extra backpacks with clothing and shoes and underwear, but keeps you warm, and get all the food that you can get together. We're going on a long walk, and it was a very long walk, because on that death march, which started out on January 18th in the morning. 58,000 people from Auschwitz I, the concentration camp, Auschwitz II, the extermination camp, and Auschwitz III, the factory camp, which was the camp that the German industry had persuaded the Nazis to install right next to the extermination camp, because they wanted, they used to say, look, all this good Jewish material you're wasting in the chimney, we can use it before they put them in the chimney. Let us use them, and then if you build us a camp next to the extermination camp, we'll use them and then hand them over to you. And in this camp existed for the whole time, and one of the largest factories there was the IBM factory, no, IG Farben factory, which tried to make artificial rubber. And all the people from Auschwitz I, Auschwitz II, the extermination, Auschwitz III, the factory camp, 58,000 people went on the march, and on the death march, in which the order of the day was bullet in the head who couldn't walk, and the roads were lined with people, because not too many were as well outfitted as we were, I would venture of 58,000 people, a good one-third, if not more, remained on the forest ways in that forest. And Werner Hahn had saved 500 people, not very many out of 58,000, but he had saved the lives of 500 people in that death march, because we were outfitted warm enough to be able to go through the snow and the cold and survive. And even on the way, we finally came to a little railroad station where they put us into railroad cars, and Werner Hahn insisted that the group that from Canada went into an open coal car, because he said, you go into a closed freight car, you could die. And he was right, and when we got to the women's concentration camp, where they hooked the women's cars up, when they opened the closed freight cars, there were corpses in there, and the people that had been in the open coal cars had survived. We were cold, we were hungry, but had survived. We stayed in Ravensbrück until April 1945, and then were deported again, but that time treated much better, because by that time the German army had asked for their prisoners of war. They wanted their prisoners back to exchange them for the people in the prisoner of war camps. And the Allies said, we don't need the people from the prisoner of war camps, because they are fairly well taken care of, but we want the concentration camp prisoners, and we want the women first. And they got the women of Ravensbrück was the only large women's concentration camp. It was not an extermination camp, concentration camp. And so they started bringing in Swedish Red Cross buses that took out by nationality the prisoners. And I could have gone with the Germans, and I could have gone with the Austrians, and I could have gone with the Czechs, but my group, and we also always formed groups, support groups, and my groups were Slovak girls. I was the only non-Slovak in the group, except another Greek girl. And so by the time the Slovaks would have been taken out, they had to evacuate the concentration camp, because Berlin was fairly close, and I think the Russians were already in Berlin, and we were evacuated on the 28th of April 1945. We came finally after 3 or 4 days, we finally came to a checkpoint, I think it must have been the second, maybe it was the third of May 1945. We came to an American checkpoint, and when there were thousands of people on that highway, because everybody was going west to their liberators, the Americans, and nobody had bothered whether we were prisoners or whatever we were just one of the bunch. But we stuck together, and when we came to this checkpoint, there were two GIs and an interpreter, former prisoner, also a prisoner in a prison uniform, on the jeep. And when we stepped up, we were 515, and I stepped up to the GIs, and I said, where do you want us to go? And he said, what do you mean? How come you speak English? I said, I learned it in school. He said, strange. I said, yeah, but where do you want us to go? And he said, well, go back where you came from. And we rolled up our sleeves and showed our numbers, and the prisoners on the, that sat in the back of the jeep said, they can't go where they came from. They come from an extermination camp. And I shall never forget that GI looking at me and looking at us and saying, what is an extermination camp? And I always had to think, there was this young man who probably had been in the war since 1942, 1941 perhaps, and had fought for the liberation of the oppressed people of Europe and had no idea who the most oppressed people were. Well, he said, I don't know what to do with you. You go into the village that was about 5 minutes away. Our CO is there in the Gasthaus and in the tavern, and that's where our headquarters is, and maybe he'll know what to do with you. And so we started out on that dusty road, that country road, unpaved country road, and all of a sudden I stopped, and I looked around. There was nobody to tell me, stop, go, sit down, turn around, lay down. It was the first time, almost to a day, within 3 years, that I was not under guard, that I was free. That was my moment of liberation. And I think I've way outspoken my time already. So all I want to like to repeat to you, I've mentioned to you the 14 high-ranking SS men and the 11 PhDs among them and doctors among them. All of you are eventually going to go to graduate school, have professions, have important professions. And if one of your professions is important enough to have a government or a multinational corporation approach you to work for them, always check what the work consists of. Because if in that work that you do for them, there is, you could hurt one human being, please remember what I told you. 11 men in Berlin Wannsee decided the fate of millions, executed millions, with their high education, with their degrees, but without humanity. So please, stay human.